So WandaVision has concluded, and you know what, to be honest, I'm pretty bummed about it. The show was just fun, it had magic, it had love, it had lost, it had all these wonderful things just kind of mismatched into an amazing love letter of all things American sitcoms. But I wanted to talk about what I thought, and just a brief little talk, if you will, about WandaVision. And of course, spoiler alerts, if you haven't seen WandaVision at this point, well, I'm just gonna talk about everything, so watch WandaVision. And with that, let's talk about WandaVision. Hello friends, hello family, welcome to another episode of Nerd News. You know what this is, a show created for nerds by, I hope you screamed back, a nerd! And in the first TV show that kicks off the MCU and the TV series, WandaVision is a great way to just start this whole TV series in a great, positive, and emotional way. I mean, Wanda by herself is just a powerhouse character, and her and Vision, that storyline is just so good. And obviously, we were supposed to see this on the big screen, but to condense it into a 9-episode little story arc was fantastic. And that's why I want to kind of just talk about certain things about the show that I loved, certain things I wish that we've seen, and just all in all, my love for everyone at Marvel. And yes, this is a little pitch for Marvel, because, you know, I know you watch my show, so hire me. I'll play anything. I'll play Puck and Alpha Flight. If you're a comic book fan, you know how ridiculous of a character that is, and it's funny. Nerd joke. But before we dive into today's episode, if this is your first time visiting my channel, hi. I would greatly appreciate it if you would select that like and just smash, actually just destroy that like. Just punch your computer screen until the like is black and blue. And also don't forget to subscribe because that's important. I don't know why I'm so hyper today, but sorry. So like I said in the opening, WandaVision is a beautiful love letter to shows like Bewitched, The Munsters, Modern Family, Dick Van Dyke, and they do it in such a beautiful way where it's really darn entertaining. So the show kicked off with a 2-episode premiere that followed the 1950s and the 1960s. Now when they filmed these two eras, they filmed it in front of a live studio audience, and they also used practical effects for all the stuff that Wanda does. From the start of this episode, for the first 2 episodes, a plethora, that's right, a plethora of clues and questions and just what the heck is going on came out of everyone's mouth after the 2 episodes. It was causing everyone to flock to Google and, you know, started typing in like, what is going on in WandaVision? Send. I don't know. Keep watching the show. Ah, touche, Google. Then we kind of mosey on down to the 1970s. That was a good year for me. I had my first kiss. At this point, we started to learn a little bit more about Wanda's control over the town, and we just realized that, oh, hexes are a thing. And one really neat thing about this show is they, in one specific opening, they covered what happens or what happened after the blip, you know, the snap. Monica Rambeau, you see her introduction, her kind of reintroduction in a way, as she's coming out of the snap. Her particles, if you will, come together and she's back in a hospital and everyone is frantic because they just populated out of nowhere and they don't know what the heck is going on. To see that aspect, you know, from what we know in Infinity Wars and Endgame, and to just to see that humanity side of like, just what the heck happened, you know? It was really chaotic and it was kind of, what's that word I'm looking for? It was really intense. I don't know why I'm doing this. I'm not milking a cow, this means intense. So the neat thing about the show up until this point is we got these cast of characters, we have this kind of clue kind of feel of like, okay, who's doing what? Who's in charge? We kind of know Wanda's in charge, but we kind of think someone else is pulling Wanda's strings. But who is it? As we move on to the 1980s and 1990s, we get a smack in the face of an end credits scene. And if you've seen the previous X-Men movies that were under Fox, you probably have, you know that Evan Peters was the coolest Quicksilver around. And the fact that he shows up at the end of that episode of WandaVision, a lot of us, including myself, was like, okay, does this mean that the X-Men universe is kind of molded into this? Is this the introduction to the X-Men and the MCU? It's the introduction, guys! And the question just kept going. I mean, why is it the younger Pietro and not the one that we saw in Age of Ultron? What the heck is going on? Now, as we reach the 2000s, this was honestly one of my favorite episodes because it was the Halloween one. And Wanda, at this point, has already seen what Vision really looks like, you know, dead. Then she sees her brother Quicksilver, aka Pietro, dead as well with, you know, bullet holes. And then we start to get a little bit more in depth into some of the characters, namely one character that I just want to talk about for a little bit. I'm going to skip a little bit in the timeline of the show and just focus on the nosy neighbor, and you know who I'm talking about. So when the show started, everyone had a little suspicion that Agnes, the nosy neighbor, there's something, I don't know, something off about her that we just didn't know. A lot of people were saying, oh no, she's the witch. And some people were saying, oh no, that's Mephisto in disguise. One of those answers was correct. This is where we're gonna start talking about actors. Here we go. Now, Catherine Hahn's performance is just fantastic. You can tell that she had the time of her life when she was playing the nosy neighbor in all those iterations of the sitcoms. But when you get the reveal that she's actually Agatha Harkness in the cellar, and you see all the, you know, the I almost said the Necronomicon. Where you see the stronghold, the book, we'll get to that here shortly. You could just tell that Catherine just had an amazing time understanding this character and how she manipulated Wanda into staying in this reality and to kind of playing with her a little bit, that she was behind the scenes of everything and even killed the dog. Also the best theme song ever, just letting you know that. So we can't talk about the actors without mentioning Elizabeth Olsen. Can I just say that that woman needs to be nominated for an Emmy for this performance? I mean, each week you see the declining sanity that is Wanda, and oh gosh, Elizabeth Olsen just delivers such an amazing performance. And of course, Paul Bettany is just one of those actors who is just bloody brilliant in everything he does. His chemistry with Elizabeth Olsen is just fantastic. You believe that they're in love, and when there's a struggle, you're like, oh no, mom's yelling at dad, please, everyone stop. And you can tell with all the actors, all the principal actors in this show just enjoyed the time period that they were in, just to have fun. It almost made me feel like the old school Batman with Adam West, how every actor from that decade wanted to be on that show to have fun, you know what I mean? To do something different, to kind of overact in a way, and to see that in WandaVision, it just made it more believable, and yet again, a beautiful love letter to those shows that came before all of this. And I'm gonna touch upon Wanda's kids in another episode, because they have a whole character arc themselves that's amazing. But the casting for them is fantastic. So remember I said the Darkhold was showcased on, you know, briefly for a second in episode 8, but fully on in episode 9, which is amazing. Well, if you're unfamiliar with the Darkhold, let me tell you. So the Darkhold is also known as the Book of Sins. Not a happy book. It's an ancient book of spells that kind of, what's the word I'm looking for? It has unspeakable evil and has this power, and those who read it, bad things happen. And the last time that we saw the Stronghold was in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., the season where you had Ghost Rider, which was amazing. And the reason why the Stronghold is such a big deal is at the end of the season finale, the series finale, episode 9, the second after credits scene, you see Wanda reading the Stronghold. And what was interesting, you probably caught this, when that end credit scene happened, you saw Wanda drinking her coffee, and she heard the tea, and so she went in to get the tea, and then the camera starts continuing on in the house, and you see Scarlet Witch reading the Stronghold, learning the spells. That's exactly how Doctor Strange learned his spells. Strange used the astral plane to project himself to learn while he sleeps, or learn spells while he does some other stuff, like, I don't know, taxes. And so with Wanda doing the same thing, Agatha said it at one point. She is destined to destroy the world, and she's destined to be stronger than the Sorcerer Supreme. So I think this is how it's gonna flow into Doctor Strange 2, the Multiverse of Madness, because she's reading things, learning these spells, this chaos magic kind of thing that's flowing through her. It's bad news bears, Walter Matthau. Now, another kind of thing that people were expecting was Mephisto, or a, Professor X was gonna have a cameo. Doctor Strange was supposed to break Wanda out of the hex. All these things didn't happen, and I'm kinda glad they didn't. And I'm glad it didn't set, and I'm glad these things didn't happen, except for Mephisto, that'd be cool. Because Scarlet Witch is the strongest Avenger. She is so powerful. Sorry, Brie Larson. and everything that went inside of the hex, inside of Wanda's world, was a really sad, just if you strip everything back, it's a sad story. I mean, almost everyone had a happy ending after Endgame, but Wanda had nowhere to go. Like, she had, her love is gone, she saw her, oh my gosh, she saw her love Vision die twice and technically a third time when she closed the hex. So Wanda has this really painful history and it's gonna continue on in the MCU. I hope she turns into a villain. I hope she does. I hope we get the No More Mutants House of M style kind of thing going on. I know this show is kind of a little bit of a nod to it, but you never know what Marvel will do. And this show is everything that we expected out of a Marvel production. There was some comedy, there was some sadness, there was a little bit of darkness going on with Agatha's basement. So that's kind of probably the kind of feel we're gonna see in Doctor Strange 2. But guys, I just wanted to sit down and talk with you, just like we would if we were hanging out at a bar or hanging out in the living room talking about Marvel stuff, because this is just fun, I love it. And I hope you enjoyed it too. But guys, thank you so much for sitting here and letting me ramble about the show that I loved. Let me know in the comments below what you thought of WandaVision and what Marvel show are you excited for next. You guys, thank you. Until next time, you know, just watch Marvel, enjoy Marvel. There are some good DC shows as well. If you haven't seen Titans, watch Titans. It's a great show. Oh my gosh, poor Vision. Wanda, I'm no longer.